Hello, overclockers. I'm 8pack, and I'm here today to discuss with you the new Ryzen 7000 series by AMD and the associated motherboards. Now, Brian has written me a script of what to say here, but obviously, I'm 8pack, so I do what I want. Okay, that being said, let's get into it. Okay, let's first discuss the stack of SKUs within the Ryzen 7000 series. You've got four SKUs. Each SKU has the new Zen 4 cores. Each SKU has the new I/O chip, which is 6nm base. They all have onboard GPU. They're all compatible with dual channel DDR5. And they all boost to different frequencies and have auto overclocking PBO boost built into them, as well as manual overclocking and are fully unlocked. Each CPU also comes with 20 PCI Express Gen 5 lanes, which can be combined across all graphics cards or storage, which is a bonus if you're just going to install one Gen 5 GPU and then one Gen 5 NVMe. Within the motherboard stack, you've got three different chipsets. The ones I've got in front of us here are both X670E chipset boards and what you'd call the elite tier or top tier. All my testing that I'm going to go through today, I've done on the X670E motherboards because that's what 8pack's about. Right, so now we've discussed a little bit about the new cores and the new stack of CPUs and obviously mentioned the new stack of motherboards as well. Let's look at the motherboards themselves and see what's physically a bit different about this new AMD product around the socket and the cooling. So firstly, let's look at the AM5 socket. Traditionally, AMD has been a ZIF style of socket, which stands for zero insertion force, and the pins that connect the CPU to the motherboard have been included within the CPU package. Now, the new AM5 socket is what we call an LGA socket, which is like a grid array where the pins are placed on the socket and you have pads on the CPU. The CPU socket then places downward force onto the CPU to press it into place. We've seen this on other sockets in the past, but never used by AMD before. Also around the socket, you'll see a very similar clamping mechanism for coolers as we saw on the AM4 or indeed AM3 sockets prior to that. And this clamping mechanism means that actually you can use any cooler that you have now that fits on AM4 to fit on AM5. Whether I'd recommend that as such is a bit up for debate. What I'm seeing with testing is that you need a minimum of a 240 AIO cooler with decent static pressure fans to get the absolute best on PBO2 tuning out of the 7700X and the 7600X, which are the 6 and 8 core SKUs. And what I'd suggest is a 360mm AIO, again with very good static pressure fans, to get the absolute best in PBO2 tuning out of the 7950X or the 7900X. Those are the 12 and 16 core SKUs, respectively. We've discussed a few fundamental changes around the socket. Let's discuss the DDR technology. This AMD platform is solely DDR5 based. It's dual channel, which means you have to include two sticks in the motherboard or four sticks in the motherboard when you're mounting to ensure full dual channel bandwidth. What I found in testing, and we've tested all the way from DDR5 5200 all the way up to DDR6000 and even beyond up to DDR6400, is that the Infinity Fabric divider remains on a one-to-one basis all the way from 5200 all the way up to 6400 on certain CPUs. What I've found is also that the benefit from overclocking memory on this platform is nowhere near as important as it was on the DDR4 platform or the AM5. What we're seeing really is a 1 to 1.5% difference in benchmarks, including things like Cinebench, 3DMark, and gaming structured benchmarks such as Heaven, Valley, and games such as Forza 5, is that we're seeing literally 1 to 1.5% improvement in performance going all the way up the DDR5 frequencies. What I suggest for the end user is really waiting to buy the very top tier DDR5 until the latencies come down to match. Because what we're seeing now is as the frequency increases, latency also increases, which means one is counteracting the other, if you like. Obviously, the absolute elite tier user who does want that 1.5% should still buy the fastest DDR5 that their CPU can run on a one-to-one divider. And both the boards here we have in front of us have run for me no problem in dual channel 6400 and no problem in dual channel, but with four sticks installed all the way up to 64 gig, no problem at 6000 megahertz. AMD have confirmed that AM5 motherboards, just like the predecessor AM4 units, will be around for several generations of CPU. So what I'd advise is, if you've got spare money, to get the best board possible to ensure forward compatibility, but not just forward compatibility, really good power delivery as we move forward and the best overclocking features. So I feel I need to discuss with you guys the temperatures that we're getting or typically seeing when we're loading these CPUs up with different types of tuning. When we're doing PBO2 tuning on the 7950X or the 7900X, under low workloads, we're seeing, you know, very reasonable temperatures, mid 70s, low 80s at the absolute most. When we're doing very heavy workloads for prolonged periods of time, however, we're seeing temperatures of around 95 to 97 degrees C using the PBO2 algorithm. And there was not much difference between the 7950X and the 7900X as far as temperatures go on multi-threaded. The same thing also happened when it came to manual overclocking, but manual overclocking had a surprisingly lower temperature than the PBO2 boost. You were talking around 88, 89, 90 degrees C absolute tops for a frequency of around 5.3 gigahertz all core overclock on either the 12 core or the 16 core parts. On the lower core count parts, temperature, whether running PBO or static overclocking, for me didn't anywhere near peak out the capacity of the cooling, and yeah, we're stuck around 90 degrees for heavy workloads, maybe slightly less. I mean, obviously to overclock manually to a static overclock of around 5.5 gigahertz, you do need a little bit more voltage, so temperatures suffer, but it was certainly not as high as PBO2 on the higher end SKUs. Okay, on to the most important part of the video, the overclocking and performance tuning. We've tried all four SKUs in the stack on these X670E motherboards we have in front of us here. The two lower SKUs, which are the 7600X and the 7700X, 6 and 8 core, we've tried on a 240 AIO with high static pressure fans. And the 7900X, which is a 12 core, and the 7950X, which is a 16 core part, we've tried on a 360 AIO. What you can expect if you're doing a PBO2 algorithm on the higher end SKUs, the 7950X is up to a 5.9 gigahertz single core loaded CPU frequency. If you're running that CPU at the highest possible load under something like Blender or very, very heavy Cinebench or Corona Bench or something like this, you can expect a drop in the frequency all the way from 5.9 for low core count loads such as gaming, all the way down to around 5.2 or 5.1. That's dynamically adjusted, of course, by your PBO2 curve and by the temperature that you can imagine effectively keep the CPU at. So the lower the temperature, the higher the frequency. The 7900X with PBO2 tuning basically boosts under single core load to around 5.7 / 5.75 gigahertz. So still a fairly mighty overclock. This one also drops to around the 5.1, 5.150, 5.2 area when under heavy Cinebench loads. The 7700X is boosting under PBO overclock to around 5.5, 5.55, and 7600X, again with a similar PBO2 tuning algorithm, is boosting around 15 megahertz less, so around 5.450 or 5.5 gigahertz. So somewhere around that ballpark figure. Again, very impressive figures for single core. Both of the lower end SKUs, if you want to call them that, are also dropping to around 5 gigahertz, 5.1 under extensive heavy loads like Cinebench. But again, staying well above the magical 5 gigahertz, or what everyone thought was the magical. Now it seems it's the norm. So that's PBO2 tuning covered on all four SKUs. How do they do when you manual overclock them? Now, obviously, it depends on what load you're going to apply to the CPUs as to which type of overclocking benefits you. If you're running for 7950X, for example, you can overclock that CPU on all 16 cores to around 5.3 gigahertz, stable for 24/7 use. So it'll run 5.3 gigahertz whether you're gaming or whether you're rendering. 7900X is very similar in terms of both overclocking and the temperatures that you see whilst you're overclocking. So you're maxing out around 5250 or 5.3 gigahertz on the top end, and getting similar loaded temperatures. The 7700 and the 7600X are actually very interesting CPUs because these CPUs have what I'd say was amazing overclocking headroom for what AMD would say in the stack were the lower end SKUs, if you like. And these, for me, especially the 7700X, is really the sweet spot for the gamer because you can overclock the CPU manually to around 5.5 gigahertz or certainly 5450. And that really gives you the same performance as PBO would for single core, but across all your cores at absolutely all times. And for me, that's the perfect balance here of performance. You know, you get the best of PBO2 at the same time as the best of a full static all core overclock. So now let's discuss some performance results in professional benchmarks. For professional benchmarking, I ran Cinebench R23, the single core and multi-thread tests. And I ran RealBench, which has some single thread, some video type editing, and some multi-core stuff. And I also ran CoronaBench, which is essentially also a rendering bench and engine. And I also did a bit of Blender to check top-end temperatures. What I found was the 7950X on PBO tuning, so boosting to around 5.9 gigahertz under single threaded load could outperform the old 5950X by up to 30% on the single threaded benchmark. Now, obviously, that's a combination of instructions per clock improvements that AMD have made in this generation and also raw frequency, which was very impressive. 30% generation on generation is a great leap forward. In the multi-core stuff, I found that the 7900X, when you applied a static overclock or indeed allowed PBO to take over, so it was running around 5.25 or 5.3 gigahertz for most of the tests in Cinebench. And obviously I did Cinebench on loop, not just one test, to make sure the variability was removed. I found that this, what you'd like, upper but mid-tier SKU was as good as the old flagship SKU. So what you were getting was around over 30,000 points on the 7900X in Cinebench R23 multi-core versus slightly less than 30,000 points on the old flagship 5950X. Again, this demonstrates both a great frequency bump from AMD and a great IPC or instructions per clock bump that they've made available. Also, interestingly, for the professional world, AMD have really pushed to add AVX 512, which is traditional Intel compiler, into the architecture of these CPUs. And I can confirm after running YCruncher, a benchmark based around AVX 512, that AMD has indeed made massive leaps forward and they're running very efficiently on AVX 512 now, and also running great on AVX 2, which is another Intel compiler, which traditionally, again, AMD has not been great at. But the pipeline, obviously, on these Zen 4 cores is not only efficient in traditionally AMD instruction sets, but also very, very efficient in Intel instruction sets. Okay, now let's go on to gaming performance. Obviously, when you're testing gaming performance, you need to run tests that make sure that the CPU is the bottleneck within the system. Most AAA titles, if you really crank up the level of detail and the resolution, you find that the GPU is the bottleneck. But if you do run games in lower resolutions or older games or maybe less taxing games on the GPU where the GPU is not absolutely maxed out, it's then the CPU and the memory, etc., that's taking the weight of pushing those frame rates. And what we find here with a PB overclock on a 7950X where it's up to 5.9 in games, or on the 7700X where it's up to 5.7 on games, we're getting a nice beefy 30% no problem improvement in those games which are going to really benefit from CPU. I mean, obviously, nowadays games need ideally 8 cores, and for this I would just do a manual overclock on a 7700X and you've got beast mode performance on a lower budget scale. Us being overclockers, we will offer a range of upgrade bundles based around the new AMD Ryzen 7000 series, and these will be 8-pack bundles initially. What I'll be offering is the 7700X and the 7600X, and I'll be calling that the approved bundle, certainly very much approved for gaming. And this will have a static overclock of between 5.45 and 5.5 gigahertz. It will use up to 6,000 megahertz memory and at least 32 gig of DDR5. The cooler that will come as standard with that configuration will be a 240 IO with high static pressure fans, with the customer having multiple upgrade paths. Obviously, the customer will be able to upgrade to even 128 gig of memory capacity. They can upgrade the cooler to 360mAh or even a pre-mounted custom water block by any of the manufacturers we list on the website. As well as approved bundles on the lower SKUs, we'll be offering elite and extreme bundles on the high-end Ryzen 7 SKUs. These will be offered with a choice of motherboards, either the Aorus Master that I have here or the Asus ROG Hero X670E motherboard. And we'll be doing the overclocking and tuning on these a little bit differently. Both of the bundles, be it Elite tier or indeed the Extreme bundle, will come with initially 32 gig, 6,000 megahertz memory all the way, which can be upgraded all the way to 128 gig of memory. They will all come as standard with a 360mm AIO cooler with high static pressure fans, which again, like the approved bundle, can be upgraded to a custom water block. But it's the tuning that will really stand out. So the 7950X, which will try to take advantage of the best of both worlds. So a PBO2 overclock for single core and lower core counts to allow the CPU to boost right up to around 5.9 gigahertz. And then we'll take advantage of a feature called OC Switcher, which means that when the CPU is pulling a certain amount of power, or in this case will be under heavy multi-threaded workloads, the CPU will then switch into a static overclock. And this will be around 5250 to 5.3 gigahertz. Essentially, it making the best of both worlds out of overclocking, because these high-end SKUs essentially are better for gaming on PBO2, but are better for content creation or very heavy workloads when you do a static overclock. An OC switcher allows us to take advantage of both of these. So the Elite tier and the Extreme bundle will be based around OC switcher, and we'll take quite a bit of tuning from us to get all the settings and get the switching exactly right. Due to the outstanding performance of the new Ryzen 7000 CPUs and the associated platform, I'll be integrating these into my 8-pack systems, as well as the bundles which I described earlier. The Meteroid, which is an ITX system, will be taking a 7900X. The frame rate will have the option of 7900X or 7950X. And the Hypercube will have 7950X with an option of a 7900X. Check out the links in the descriptions below if you want to pick up any of the bundles that I've discussed in the video. Also, leave us a comment and tell us which SKU is the one for you. I'm sure most people for raw gaming will be looking at the 7700X or the 7900X. Those would probably be my choice. And for the pro user, 7900X or 7950X, very, very solid, really good raw performance. Now, please don't like the video, don't subscribe, but do check out the triceps.